Welcome back to Politics Watch. This is Serpy. Now, today I'm going to talk about the night when Gerald Levy, aka Bogle, lost his life. That night is important, not just because of the fact that obviously Bogle was a big star, right, and what happened to him, but it was the culmination of some events, right, that highlighted the best and worst parts of the culture. Let's go back to that night. The date, well, some of you remember, 19th of January 2005 was a Wednesday, right? But officially, he lost his life on January 20th, 2005, because you don't know, once the clock touched midnight, the day changed, right? So enough people, because it was a weddy Wednesday, a lot of people say, you know, Bogle lost his life on the Wednesday, but, you know, officially, it was actually the early Thursday morning, right? So, what happened to the man who is routinely credited as the greatest dancer, right, in dancehall history, right, somebody who is very influential not just in Jamaica and the Caribbean but even abroad? Well, before I can get to that part, let's look at the build-up. Now, even before the music, Bogle was known as being a member of the Black Roses crew, right? I don't know, he was rolling it Willie Agart on a Monday. Now, you can find many videos on YouTube with Bogle and Willie Agart at dance. Bogle had a very positive impact on Willie Agart. I've said this in the Willie Agart video, right? There are some people, when they are around, they're known for raise the spirit of others and make everybody laugh and enjoy themselves and party, and even people who are normally, you know, more abrasive. When a certain individual come around, them start to become more fun and jovial. That's the impact that Bogle had on Willie Agart. He also had the same impact on many other people. Right, so Bogle, known as a Roses man, right? If you've ever seen him, you can tell right away Bogle was just different. In any crowd, in any group, him just stand out. Him dressed different from everybody, right? Him danced different from everybody. He was just a standout figure. Bogle was uber talented. Some people just have that certain, what the French call je ne sais quoi, right? He just had that for dancing. Very, very talented youth. But despite being a gifted dancer, right, and entertainer in general, Bogle, naturally being a part of an organization like Black Roses crew, right, Bogle was also getting himself involved in some little problem or going on the streets, right? Remember, Willie Agart dropped out, right? He didn't even get to a point where Bogle left for cut left Jamaica, right? They were firing for a while, right? People them say, boy, Bogle run around him now, come back now. Bogle not ever come back to Jamaica again, come on, want him life. Right, things did get real tense for Bogle, but he eventually come back into the place and took back his spot as the premier dancer on the dancehall scene. Now, me know enough people right now are flashback to maybe when they were younger, right? And I remember when Buju Banton come out to the Bogle dance, right? Everybody did swear, said they are the biggest dancer in the world. Bogle convinced half of Jamaica, say my big dance. All who can dance, I dance Bogle. To be honest, it's arguably, of all the dances them what we can think of in a Jamaican history, it's probably the dance where I saw the people them get captivated with the most. Bogle dance and the interestingly named Willie Agart dance, those two dances, for me, are just permanently etched in my memory based on how I see those dances just take the country by storm. Like, you're used to seeing hit songs, right? He used to have a hit song and everybody was singing, right? Bogle was dropping hit dances, right? The whole country, I take it on. So after returning to Jamaica, and you don't know, Black Roses lose most of them strength by this point now, and Bogle was now focusing mostly on him dancing, which is what he should have been doing from day one anyway. Bogle start to link back with the artist them, and, you know, him become the dance, him the wave, and him come with all kind of things, full of style. Right. Very, very talented man, as me say. Right. But Bogle, right, one of the people him who Bogle a par with was Beanie Man. Beanie Man and Bogle had a very good relationship because, as you know, Beanie Man and Roses used to also par. Beanie Man used to par with Pan Agart, him Khan, and well-known runner Jungle and him place there. Right. Because you remember the World Dance video, right? All-time classic. Right. That video was shot when Roses Khan. That song and Beanie Man helped to put Black Roses' name at the international stage. That link, when you think about it, was very beneficial for all the various parties. Beanie Man, the artist, was linking with the dancer who would create the dance, right, create the style, and then Beanie Man could sing about the style. Then Black Roses would get their name mentioned, right, they would become popular, their image would get bigger, right, it would help their street cred. Anytime they roll in at the party, everybody knows, say, from PPS or Black Roses crew, them instantly remember them from the song, right, so now they're getting their own notoriety. Bogla get fame, think bigger, because artists are sing about him and people halfway around the world are hear about this Bogla individual. So at the time, it was a very beneficial network. The three of them really are mover, the artist, the dancer, and the crew. But this is what people need to understand. Because we'll get into how things get ugly further on, leading up to how Bogla lost his life. But let me just make a little segue right here, now. Dancehall music. Because all of this happened inside a dancehall. Let's look at dancehall for a brief second. A genre that, contrary to what Simon tell you, I'm actually a fan of. But I'm a fan of dancehall, not dancehall. Let me say that again, because there's two of them. There is dancehall, and there is dancehall. People say, well, Serpy, oh, you know the difference. I'll tell you the difference between dancehall and dancehall. So dancehall, just like reggae music, right? Originally, you don't know, it was started by the people, for the people, right? A poor people music, right? The majority of the people who were the original pioneers, ghetto youths, right? Sufferers, right? People who at the time were using their voice to talk about various things that must surround them. In some cases, it would literally serve as the voice of the people. And even though a lot of the old school artists did not have much formal education, right, they still had a level of intelligence where they could look around them, look at a situation, process it, translate it into music, and make it connect with the people. That is why some of those songs, even to this day, when people play them, it sounds like the first time you hear them. Those kind of music, that type of music, simply can't dead. Dancehall is also one of the biggest fathers in the world, right? They see me do the video where they about breeder. Well, you can treat dancehall music like a breeder. What do you talk about, Sir P? Dancehall have Wodipa Pitney. All over the world, dancehall have a lot of children running around, right? Reggae and dancehall. We talk about things like reggaeton, right? And all these kind of things heavily influenced by dancehall. But here's the thing. Dancehall Pitney them go and get bigger than the father. Dancehall children, reggaeton, and you see South America and them place there. Them take them style from reggae and dancehall and go and go turn it in a multi-billion dollar industry. Pitbull and them artists there from Latin America. They're making far more money and they are far more successful than even the biggest dancehall artists them. Dancehall Pitney are outshine the father. The student is outshining the master. I'm going to tell you one of the reasons why that happened. That happened because of dancehall. You see, dancehall, can I just tell you what dancehall is? Dancehall, very powerful voice of the people, right? Have messages that last 5, 10, 15 years, I'm now still relevant. That's dancehall. Dancehall. Well, that's when the man them allow them ego to lead them astray. Dancehall, that's when you have people, right, who, even though they're talented, very talented, right, can make words rhyme and put songs together and ride rhythm and all these things. Soon as they enjoy a little taste of success and them start make a little money, here comes L-I-Q-itis. You see, dancehall, talk to the people who are really in the industry. Talk to the producers, talk to the artists them, right? The one them where, especially the one them really in the video like that, talk to them and they will tell you. Dancehall is one of the most cutthroat industries you'll ever find. When you talk about people being just wicked and covetous and setting up each other and fight against each other and, you know, it's funny them, so you, Sure, pay a fight against the artist. You want to know who fight against? Ask artists about other artists. Ask artists about other producers. Ask producer about other producers. Dunsall can't tell nobody about fight against. Dunsall are the pioneers of fighting against people. See, while dancehall used to stand for something, dancehall stands for nothing. Dancehall is driven entirely by hype. Dancehall is you take the mic, chat your lyrics, make we hear how good it really is. Then me I go chat my lyrics, and then the people them I go decide what the baddest art is. And we are gonna stay up on this stage all night if we have to. And we not go back no gun, we not go back no knife. We not go carry no friend can help warrior. The lyrics on this stage will settle it live. That's dancehall. Dancehall? Well, that's just about saying the most outlandish things them they can think of to provoke a reaction. And here's the thing. Dancehall, it make people sit up and take notice. And dancehall artists interpret that as success. Dancehall artists say, oh look, see, when I say that, everybody look for me, and now, I'm now the biggest thing in the world. Dancehall artists never realize that strategy, right? Of just saying wild and all these things out, things to shock people, you know, shock on our lyrics. Dancehall artists never realize that wear off very quickly. And the people them start to say, okay, we are for we know. That is why dancehall artists don't last very long. That is why dancehall artists who haven't even dropped an album from the 90s still have been getting more consistent bookings than enough dancehall artists. When I even realize that you have some artists from the 90s, early 2000s, who even though they're not quote-unquote hot in Jamaica, they might tour some place where your favorite dancehall artist can go. And when time them go to Europe, the people them in Germany and France, we can't even speak English, I sing them song word for word. Where your favorite dancehall artist who burn up the whole of the sidewalk them, Kingston, St. Andrew and Moby, where you go to play, man, I say the biggest thing in the world. Here I'm going to Germany and ask nobody about him. Nobody knows about your dancehall artist. Music now has substance. Some of these little lyrics where dancehall artists write, a chimpanzee can write them lyrics. Some of the rhythm them where these dancehall artists are depend, a chimpanzee can make them rhythm them. Nothing special, nothing memorable. Here today, gone tomorrow. Trash. Dancehall? Don't worry, I get back to Bogle coming up. I'm going to wonder. Well, sir, I go with this. Don't worry yourself. One drink on the tea, one drink on the Cersei Bush. Dancehall. Don't you find it strange how a song from the 90s, literally released about 20 years ago, when it dropped in one of these parties like yesterday's and then party day, every time I hear it, it's like the first time I hear it again. That's what happened when dancehall music is made. Some of the rhythms, some of the man they used to make them time there. Listen, when they talk about the Kelly brothers, Dave and Tony Kelly, I don't know how the man they do them thing, right? Obviously, we're not about producing music, but I don't know. I remember very clearly the first time I heard the Breakout rhythm. You know, some people remember that rhythm there. Breakout, Breakout. The first time I heard that rhythm, right, the first song me hear it pon, the first song me hear play pon that rhythm, was The Killer was saying, I can't believe my eyes. And I remember listening to the rhythm, me used to have a CD, and track one was just the rhythm. And then like track two, then it started going on a song, but track one is just the rhythm. I remember listening to the Breakout rhythm, and thinking to myself, what kind of alien, sci-fi, Star Wars, intergalactic noise is this? I've never heard anything like that in my life. And from then, I knew this rhythm will live forever. Dave Kelly and Tony Kelly rhythm them, right? And you have Shocking Vibes and some other crew, but you see, them rhythm them, they will outlive Dave and Tony Kelly. They might go dead left them rhythm them. And they will still be relevant 20-30 years from now. But probably the biggest difference between dancehall and dancehall is the state of mind. Dancehall make the people of Jamaica feel proud. Dancehall is straight up embarrassing. Dancehall is when musical rivalries spill out onto the street and people start war and citizens start to divide themselves and man start decide to kill themselves over artists who don't even care about them. That's dancehall. Let's move back to Vogel. Now, something was playing out that at the time, and it was not like that yet. I've heard about artists and artists having beef and artists falling out and artists a clash. What we were seeing was dancer versus dancer. By now, Beanie Man and Vogel were not as close as them once or what they used to be. Now, Beanie Man and Janai apart, and Vogel and Theme Crew, right, are now having a rivalry between Janai and Beanie Man crew. At the time, it seemed innocent. Two star dancers, a square off, were the biggest dancer. It seemed very harmless. People were even encouraging it because enough people were thinking to themselves, well, we want to see what the new youth and the black can do. Right? We want to see what God Bogle already established at the top, man. Even though Janai at the inner of the streets are doing things long time. Right, Shelly Billy and if people have understand enough of these names that people are here now, Shelly Billy and them named a long time they meet that dance, long time, right? But at the time, you know, Bogle was like the main person, right? He was like the face of dancing. But they have some local youths, and one of them youth they rise up became very big, Janai. So now the two stem on them, right, had them local rivalry, and it seemed innocent, but things we're starting to take a more sinister turn. We start to hear, say, man gonna party and liquor dash up on man, right? And people end up, I get draped up and I was thinking to myself back then, because I remember this period clearly. I remember thinking to myself then, dance and dance, oh, that doesn't sound like nothing to do with dancing. Man, I get wet up, right, with liquor and all kind of foolishness. I'm thinking to myself, that ain't necessary. The man never cut it up before it get ugly. Well, Bogle, being the talented entertainer he was, decided to say, even the dancing alone is not enough. The man them have song, dancer start drop song, right? Bogle come out with a thing, we say all them there, well all them there did there, right? Next thing we hear, Janai drop the answer. This was an extraordinary time in the culture. Dancer versus dancer, imagine two dancers of two of the biggest among them in a dance hall. I don't know if somebody can mention a period back in the 80s and them times, but for me, at the time it seemed unprecedented. Dancers a drop song and a clash and a answer back. Janai come back with the style, we say, you want to know where Janai did they a run of roses, run the way they are when you run me. Then we hear Boko come back again and say, them go answer. Extraordinary times. If the man in the keep it at a level, keep it at the you know the music level and go back and forth and who knows where them could have reached. I'm telling people about being short-sighted, you know, ego, foolishness. Things start to escalate. Man, I got a party, man. People start to look for each other. Place I get tense. Some patrons that say, boy, them don't want to go to the party because they say, them here say man get drip up at the last party because the two cool them in there. So when people here say two cool them, I got that one venue them they want go. That's the thing I reach. Now we're getting towards that night. Of course, talking about January 19th, 2005 at Weddy Wednesday. I want you to look at your screen right now. That is a dancehall party with real life chickens or fowl, and the man might fling up the fowl, I feed the Bogle was literally DJing both the thing them and then bring it to real life. You may spot right beside where the action are going, right to them feed the fowl and cut the fowl upon like one look a rope in on, you know, gimmicks. entertainment, making the people them laugh. Well, some people, not everybody will find it funny. You can see in the clip, Beanie Man was there, right in front of all this agodong. I'm going to post the full video on the website, politicsquash.com, as well as an interview with Bogo Driver, who describes in great detail what went down that night, right? So, the person who owned the video, don't worry yourself, I'm not going to download it, I'm going to just post your link, and you can get your views them or whatever, right? Don't nobody feel like me taking on the fan them, right? However, this is what was playing out. Can you imagine being in a party? When you watch the video, you see Fowler fly up in the air, Fowler drop on people. Bogo them carry the thing to a new level. This was a new level of escalation. As me say, as you can see on the video, Beanie Man stand up there. So, them left weddy. There's a gas station, right? Back then it was a Esso. I think now it's now a Total, right? Right at the top of Dunrobin Road right there, so, right? Canton Spring Road. Bogo them pull in to get gas. Two man pull up on bike. Let's just say the man them deal with Bogle harsh. Man them mash up Bogle. The great, great Bogle. People were wondering, what go on? Because we also hear say, I remember very clearly we hear say, Mataran dead too. So people are saying, initially, Bogle and Mataran? You mean Vitel, we say, dancehall culture? Get so deep in a dancehall culture that we end up lose Bogle, right? The greatest dancer, and we lose Tony Mataran, way, legendary selector, in a one night. But of course, it wasn't Tony Mataran, right? But at the time, enough people never know that, right? But that's what we were hearing, right? Bogle and Mataran, right? But the Mataran who did lose his life was a different individual. But after they, it get clear, we said it wasn't Mataran the selector. It was just Bogle and other people get injured and people lose them life. People start to simmer down, and guess what happened? By the next morning, it was retaliation. Retaliation for what, you may ask? Well, the original word on the street was that a Beanie Man do it. Beanie Man and Janipe. Why was Beanie Man the main suspect, you may ask? Well, as I said, leading up to it, there was a rivalry going on between Beanie Man and Janipe and Bogle and Fame Crew. And then, because on the same night, Bogle in a weddy, and they were choked the foul them in front of Beanie Man, and they were mocking and jeering, and you know, people are saying, well, guess what? That must mean, say, a Beanie Man them make man kill Bogle. That was the Beanie Man was the first main suspect. By the streets. The police never officially charged Beanie or bring in Beanie for nothing, right? And say a Beanie. But due to what happened at weddy, people were convinced, see there, Beanie Man, get that man kill off Bogle. Next thing we hear, say, Janipe people in place, right? When a jungle, Bondong, right? House boy, Janipe have to take for himself and a lay low. It didn't even get to a point that even Beanie Man never take a trip out of the country. Right. Cool off. Then we hear say, Beanie Man offer $1 million reward, shocking vibe, step in, bring up more money. Some people say, boy, are cherry tricks. See, then kill off Bogle and then I give out reward money. And of course, most of you remember, Beanie Man was vehemently denying any wrongdoings, right? Beanie Man was saying, listen, him now have nothing to do with what happened to Bogle. Him and Bogle was close, him wouldn't do that to Bogle. Some people never want to hear it. This was one of the first time I can remember seeing Beanie Man's career being at a low point. Beanie Man, I'm one of them artists, you know, him and Killer and them, and them just, because their legacy is so strong, right, them they really need no hit song, them always just have a certain level of relevance because them fan base strong, right? And them catalog is so vast. But I remember clearly Beanie Man's back was against the wall. People them said, then you mean to tell me, say, because of some look chicken, because them a throw up foul, them being, people were turning on Beanie Man. And no matter what him say, enough people simply never want to hear it. people were also stunned that the culture, especially a dancing culture, would escalate to the point where somebody would lose them life. But then people started to say, listen, Bogle used to be a part of Roses. Bogle didn't even get shot previously, right? So are we sure of what happened with Beanie Man lead to his death? No, people start to ask questions. People are saying, well, Bogle had other rivals. But then that will be immediately countered with, yeah, but you mean to tell me, say, it just so happened that all this going on very, very, and then right after I'm dead, it seemed like a coincidence that was just simply too good to be true. People were divided. One camper say, Beanie Man simply can't do something like this. People say, then can't imagine Beanie Man doing something like this. And next people I say, the next that I say, well, why would he be surprised? Beanie is the part, Roses and Beanie always have Batman round him and them thing, right? I remember it very clearly. The nation, right, the culture was divided. But even though the streets was divided, some people I say, I must Beanie, others I say, I can't Beanie. What was very interesting was that at no point the police never seemed to be leaning towards the angle Sabini, right? He was never, they never lock him up or charge him and say, listen, Beanie Man is now on the investigation of the killing Bogle, right? And this ended up being one of the biggest arguments for the side of the crowd where I say it can't be Beanie, because people are saying, what do you really think, say? The police might have a chance for bringing a Beanie Man for the murder of a Bogle and I take it, right? I remember clearly that was one of the big arguments at the time, right? Now, it was looking like, say, nobody now get charged, right? The Bogle dead. Even though it happened in a very public setting, the driver spoke about it. The driver even said that there was another entertainer in the gas station when it went down, right? As I said, the interview will be on the website, but I don't want to just read off his words line for line, right? But then, October 2005, it come out in the news. Somebody has been charged for Bogle's death. People start celebrating. People are saying, see, you know, the case, I go get solved and Bogle will get justice. Well, an individual by the name of Ricardo Palmer was charged, right, for 2 counts of murder, 3 counts of shooting and illegal possession of a firearm. Now, I've been trying to get updates as to how that case went down, because Jamaica is a place where even if you're Bogle, you can lose your life, and somehow all the information about your case just completely disappears. Like, say, after the story in the hat, you know, but I gone away, right? Because I couldn't find much details, because after being initially charged, I'm assuming, say, in both the case, right, or I don't know, right? But regarding anybody getting found guilty and sentenced for Bogle's death, that never happened. Or the other individual, Mr. Reed, a.k.a. Mataran, right? Because two of them lose their life on the same night. So nobody went to jail for it. So all we really have are a bunch of theories, right? People just have a lot of names, right? People tell us, say, well, oh, Gardner man them, a Chris Royal them take you right. People tell us, say, oh, a stranger them take you right. People tell us, oh, Ricardo Palmer take you right. And people say, oh, a Beanie Man send him go do it. And lots of theories are out there. Nobody got a jail fee. Nobody has been to jail for it. Beanie Man has had to talk about this many times. In his entire career, it's probably the thing where Lingo over him made the most. Matter of fact, even after the whole thing dead down, because Beanie Man proves that music, a hit song, can solve any problem. Because when it look like, say, people are saying, well, see, you know, Beanie Man have to go hide out, man, Beanie Man have to go lay low. Beanie Man drop a song and say, them tell one bag a lie, big hit song. Big hit song. Jamaica was like, you know what, Beanie Man is back, and the whole Bogle talk just dead dumb. Completely dead dumb. And people were saying, yeah man, see there, that's the Beanie Man we know and love, we can't be no Beanie Man. A lot of people were saying, move on, leave it alone, in the get charged, Beanie Man innocent. Way down the road, out of nowhere, another legendary dancer, known as Labba Labba. It's like a man go put a phone in front of Labba Labba and Labba Labba start talking. Say, boy, listen, Beanie Man then call Chris Royal and give him 100,000 if you could carry out the hit, and next thing you know, be a problem. Just like that, Beanie Man was back in the spotlight. Beanie Man and Bogle's death was back in the news. Again, of course, me and the man denied it, right? Vehemently, saying I had nothing to do with it, right? Shortly after, I was the Labba come back out and said, well, you know, he was under so on the spirits, you know, the spirits that make him attack certain things, and you know, he had like him, like Labba said, he was hanging around with Ray and his nephew. People are saying, well, you see it? Them bad up Labba Labba. Them bad up Labba Labba to make him change him out because Labba Labba said this. Why man come out now and come say, in the drunk, he never look drunk? Next camper say. Then, or if it, or if you take somebody serious on you, Labba Labba, you don't know him at all about theories. That's all we have. See, whenever I do my own inquiries into who actually shoot Bogle, the problem I realize is people have more name than the amount of shooters they took part in the hit. We know that a two-man carried out the ops. But when you hear the name them, I'm more than two man. So something is not adding up. Even people who live in other place know the different individuals them well. None of them seem to be on the same page. So people, I don't know. Because I was even supposed to drop this video from way up in the year. Way up in the year, but I kept saying, you know what? I want to do this video when I actually have, because I say, listen, this is what happened. Like how I do like a Klansman Vera Stone Crusher video, because you already know. In certain organizations, I have much deeper reach, right? But every time I kept digging and asking, the answers were just all over the place, right? So that is how I have to conclude. I don't know. What I do know is that the greatest dancer Jamaica has ever produced lost his life, spooky circumstances, in a senseless act of violence, and for what? See, even though Bogogan understands something, dancing is not dead. We have dancers now, where in my opinion, the approach that them take is better than the approach where they go down between Bogle and Janaip and them and the back in the day. Even though Bogle, when it comes down to pure talent, Bogle is the king. But you would like Ding Dong, I have to be honest, I love the approach Ding Dong is taking. Ding Dong carried to a level where Bogle didn't take it. I'm talking about the musical side of it. It's when Bogle, even though Bogle kick off the world, all them know them they did it. If Bogle did keep at the music thing, then he could have been doing what Ding Dong do. And then who knows, he'd probably still be around. Ding Dong learned the blueprint and carried it to a new level. I really like how them do them thing, make them music, fling them shoulder, make them money and just go on about them business. That's how it should be. That's how it should be. This whole heap of war, dancer, war and art, foolishness. Can you imagine dancer war? Dancer, you know? A war. Let me say, really like how Ding Dong them do them thing. Right? I'm really curious to it. Now we see what could have been. Now we see where Bogle could have taken it. But whatever the case may be, he lost his life. He did not get justice. His mother did not understand his loss. His mother took a huge, Bogle's loss took a huge toll on his mother, as you would expect. But like many other people in Jamaica, murdered and nothing come out of it. Nothing no come out of it. It's a shame. I'm going to end this one for today, people. Patreon squad, big up on yourself. PIA, you don't know, more life. Vulture squad, I know you're circling today. Right. I don't know. Remember this song we said, Janko said, me work on a Sunday. I lie that upon a Sunday. Vulture squad work. Right. Because you know, a Janko is a vulture. Right. Vulture squad always circle around on a Sunday because, you know, maybe they might pick up a little one thing here and there and, you know, them can eat our food, but nothing wrong with that. Even scavengers have to eat. People, bless up.